Hi friends, we're doing things a little bit differently this week. I have a couple of book signings I've been planning to go to this week, and I thought I would take you along. So it is currently Tuesday, May 10th, and today I'm going to the launch event for Café con Leche, written by Emery Lee, of course, with Emery Lee, moderated by Johnny Casavilla, and that is happening here in San Diego at the Mystery Galaxy Bookstore. That's going to be happening later this evening, so still quite a bit of time between now and then, but I do plan to get there a little bit early, maybe scout out the place, do some shopping maybe, and of course, buy a copy of Emery's book. I do plan to catch up with Johnny and Emery either before the event or afterwards. We'll see what happens, but it should be a really good time. And for anyone wondering, yes, I have met both Emery and Johnny in person before. We met a couple of weekends ago at Y'all West, even though I didn't do a great job of documenting that. It did happen, so we have met, and I enjoyed hanging out with them. It was just good vibes. So yeah, that's the plan. That's what I have going on as of right now. I do plan to go to another signing later this week, but I will talk about that more later this week. And part of why I'm making this a vlog is so that I can hold myself accountable and actually document the experience, take videos, take photos, because I do such a bad job of doing that when I'm left to my own devices. While we're here, I thought I would show you what I brought along to read on this little vacation, this little trip of sorts. Of course, I brought more books than I can actually read because that's just who I am as a person. Although I did get here pretty early yesterday and I had the house to myself for a bit, so I did finish this first book, which was Man of War by Cory McCarthy. You're gonna see me talking about this in like a wrap up or probably on Bookstagram, but I really, really enjoyed this. And also my sister has a lot of like nautical decorations in her house, so I might try to take some Bookstagram photos with this while I'm here. My second option I brought with me just in case was my arc of Beauty and the Becheron by Lily Vale. This is like a super summery, cute YA rom-com between two Indian American teenagers, and it's sort of like an enemies to lovers kind of dynamic between academic rivals, and I'm really enjoying it so far. Especially when I'm like on vacation, I like to really read romances. I don't know, there's just something just fun and quick and just enticing about them that I really enjoy, so that's an option. And the last book I brought with me is a library book that I might actually try to start during today's reading hour. I'm gonna be holding it kind of awkwardly because I'm covering up the library sticker, but that is a copy of The Cartographers by Peng Shepherd. This has been like a super popular recent release. It's about like families and history and maps and all of that combining together somehow. So it sounds really fascinating and I can't wait to read it. I could also potentially start listening to this one on audiobook, which is also a really big draw for me because then I could be listening to this one and also reading physically Beauty and the Becheron, so it could be like a two things happening at once sort of situation, which works for me most of the time. So those are the three books I brought with me on this little like vacation, even though I definitely can't read three books in 2 days, but that's my life. I am who I am. So it should be a good day. I do have the house to myself again right now, so I'm just gonna be relaxing and keeping it low key, but I will show you what I'm up to leading up to the event and then of course the event itself. So enjoy.
Sometimes people kind of think, oh, like romantic tension, that just means they think each other are attractive. And it's like, no, 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 no. Like there's so much more to like you want them to essentially not be able to get the other person out of their head. And so that's why one of the reasons I love enemies to lovers so much is because it starts with, you know, it doesn't have to start with, oh my God, he's so cute, I love him. It can start with, oh my God, I hate him so much. All I can think about is how much I hate him. And so I think when you're like building up a romance, it's really important to make it so that the characters are really thinking about each other even when the other is not around. And I love like when you're writing, especially like with that hate to love, when you have that gradual progression from, oh my god, I hate him, to, oh my god, I hate him, but he's also kind of cute, to, oh my god, he's really cute, and that makes me hate him even more. And now you have, like, this really, like this really strong, like, romantic tension between them that really just, like, magnetizes the two characters together. I think that's probably, like, my absolute favorite thing to do in a romance, is just really have those characters, like, just, like, frustrated by how much they think about the other character.
Alright, so I totally just ate breakfast while rewatching an episode of One Tree Hill, as one does, and now I'm finally ready to debrief about last night. Overall, it was a really wonderful experience. I love the venue, such a great bookstore, such a great place and great people, and just a really intimate crowd of maybe like 20 or so people, and it was also being like simultaneously broadcast online, which I haven't seen done before, and that was really interesting. So there were audience questions from people who were physically there, but then also some virtual questions being submitted online, so I thought that was a really nice touch. Emery and Johnny, of course, did a really great job. Love the conversation together. They always have a great flow going on between them. Lots of laughs, lots of personality. So I just really enjoyed listening to them and hanging out with them before and after the event. I did buy two books, which I will share with you now. One is obvious, of course. So of course, at the Mysterious Galaxy bookstore, I picked up a hardcover copy of Kathy Kon Lichi by Emery Lee, of course, and I got it signed. So there's a little peek at the title page and the signing. I thought it was really cool. Here's some close-up cover action, and I love that there's also food details on the back as well. well. The hardcover itself is like this gold color. I think the color scheme is just brilliant. In case you don't know, Café con Leche is a queer contemporary YA romance. It's enemies to lovers about these two boys whose families own two very different competing restaurants. According to the dust jacket, Theo's family owns an Asian American cafe and Gabi's family owns a Puerto Rican bakery, and then a new fusion cafe comes to town and threatens both of those businesses, and they have to find a way to work together to potentially save their family stores. I cannot wait to read this. I absolutely love Meet Cute Diary. It was such a great trans rom-com, and I'm sure this is going to be another great queer rom-com as well, and I've heard great things so far. Loved everything Emery had to say about it. I think it's going to be fantastic. The other book I picked up while I was there was a paperback copy of The Girl and the Ghost by Hannah Alkoff. I wanted to get a copy of this because it's my Patreon pick for May, and it's a Malaysian sort of folktale, fairy tale story for middle grade readers that has been on my radar for such a long time. I believe it's about a young Malaysian girl named Suraya whose grandmother passed away, and she was either a witch or she possessed magic or something like that, and she left Suraya with this companion ghost. This ghost, whose name is Pink, becomes very good friends with Suraya in her loneliness, and the stronger their connection grows, the more powerful Pink becomes. But Pink also has a very dark side as well, and now Suraya has to find a way for them both to save themselves before they're pulled into darkness. I've heard so many great things about this story from reviewers I implicitly trust, and of course, like I said, I've had this on my radar for such a long time, I cannot wait to finally get to it in May. So those are the two books I picked up last night. Like I said, overall, a really great experience. Super glad I came out to go to this event, and I really had a great time. Like I said before, I am planning to go to another event this week if everything works out, fingers crossed. So hopefully in the next clip, I will be talking to you about that, so I will see you then. My eyes are red because I just got out of the shower, and I'm a little bitch. That cannot make it in the final version of this video. Just stop. Hi friends, today is Friday the 13th. That's right, it's May 13th, 2022, and today I'm gonna be driving into Culver City to attend the joint launch event with Emery Lee and Sonora Reyes that is happening at the one and only Ripped Bodice. Obviously, Emery Lee is the author of Meet Cute Diary and Café con Leche, and then Sonora Reyes is the debut author of The Lesbiana's Guide to Catholic School, which I read earlier this year, and it is definitely one of my favorite books of 2022. You may have seen me talking about this on Instagram. I also talked about it in my March wrap up. Both of those things will be included down below. I highly, highly recommend it. This book won't officially be out until next Tuesday, May 17th, but there was early permission given so that this event could happen a little bit early. As you can see, this is an ARC and I will be getting a finished copy at tonight's event. You may have seen from earlier in this very vlog that I have in fact met Sonora before in person. I met them a few weeks ago at Y'all West and then again earlier this week at Emery's launch event, and we did get a photo together holding Emery's book, which I did include in this vlog, but I will show it again in case you missed it. So I'm really excited for them with the upcoming launch of their book. I think it's going to be a super fun event. Johnny is once again moderating the conversation, and I'm just really excited to see who comes out. It should be fantastic. So that's pretty much all the preface and context that you need for this next portion of the vlog. I will do my best to show you all the wonders of the Ripped Bodice. It is a wonderful venue and bookstore. I have been there before, and it's just absolutely delightful. As I said, it should be a good time. So without any further ado, let's go!
different because she was outed at her old school, like before the book even starts, and then she goes back into the closet, so she has a chance to do it again and come out on her own terms this time, and she gets to like experience kind of both, like what it's like to have that on your own timeline, on your own terms, and to be able to choose like when you come out, who you come out to, and all the different ways that you can do it, because you have to come out more than once, like you can't just do it one time, you have to come out to these people and then these people and then these people. Yeah, so I thought it was really neat to let Yami experience the freedom to get to decide when to come out and to do it on her own terms.
I knew I wanted to write like a person of color relationship, because like, who wants to date a white person? Because I feel like when growing up, right, I always thought I had to write white characters. And then, like, as I got older, I was told, like, oh, you can have, like, a token person of color side character. So now you're like, okay, cool, we can have a black love interest, but that's the only melanin we're getting. And then I feel like to be told, like, no, 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 you can literally write the entire cast looking like you and nobody can stop you. That's when you're like, I'm all powerful, nobody can stop me. And once I got over that hurdle and I realized, like, I can write every character as a character of color, like, it was kind of like, there's no going back. Like, why am I going to keep trying to write people who don't ring true to me? Like, when I can just write people who are natural to me. And like, as far as like coming out stories, coming out is like a part of life as a queer person, right? It can sometimes be this big massive thing, sometimes it's not, but like pretty much every queer person comes out at some point or another, right? Just like we learn to drive cars, just like we go to proms, just like we do all these other things as high school students, like it makes sense that like coming out is just a part of life. So why would you say that like coming out is stories are dead? Like imagine if someone was like, you're never allowed to write another prom story. Like, you're not allowed to write another story where someone learns to drive. Like, you're not allowed to write a story where someone goes on a first date. Like, it's ridiculous, right? Like, these are just facts of life. We should still write about them. And, like, when it comes to, like, being a person of color, it's, like, the way that we're going to write about it, too, is going to be so dramatically different. I don't believe in killing tropes. I don't believe in killing, like, anything that, like, you know, it's people like it for a reason. Like, people write about it, you know? And I'm not always going to write coming out stories. I don't usually write coming out stories. But I do feel like, why can't I write one? Like, I'm going to write whatever the fuck I want. Yeah. I mean, so, like, honestly, I just feel like there are so many things that gays can and should be bad at that we just don't see represented in fiction. So, like, I'm hoping that'll be, like, my legacy. Is just really showing how much gays can fuck up in like a 360 page book.
I am back by popular demand. Good morning. It is Saturday, May 14th, and I'm here to give you a quick debrief. Overall, it was a super wonderful experience. I'm really glad I made the time to get out there, especially because it's always a good time visiting the Rip Bodice, but especially so when you're there to celebrate and support your friends. I'm so proud of Sony, especially because this was their first ever in-person event, and I think they did a great job. And just because I genuinely and truly love their book so much, and I know it's going to mean so many things to so many people, and I can't wait for people to actually get their hands on it. The conversation was absolutely stellar. Hopefully you caught a few clips in there as well, but there were some great questions about the importance of letting BIPOC characters fall in love with other BIPOC characters, the importance of developing platonic relationships, and also why marginalized authors should be allowed to write coming out stories and whatever tropes they so choose. It felt like a really good balance of interesting craft questions, along with Sony and Emery and Johnny just clowning on each other and having a good time. The conversation once again felt incredibly natural, and I think that's because obviously the three of them are genuinely friends and they genuinely care about each other's work so much, and that definitely comes across. I think that's all there is to say about the event itself. Hopefully you enjoyed coming along for the ride, and of course I did buy a few things, which I can show you now. Here's my little Rip Bodice bag. I will be keeping that for reasons. To once again start with the obvious, I did, of course, pick up a hardcover copy of The Lesbiana's Guide to Catholic School by Sonora Reyes. I literally just saw the back for the first time, and like, look at these like shoes and Yami's bracelet. Like, it's just fantastic. For those wondering, the naked hardcover is this really cute pastel pink. Anyways, if for some reason you don't know by now, this is a queer Latina YA contemporary story about a young girl named Yamilet who is of indigenous Mexican descent, and she has just not had the best experiences as a queer person existing in the world. old. Before the story begins, she was actually publicly outed by her now former ex-best friend, which of course was a huge violation and absolutely ridiculous. At the same time, her younger brother Cesar is a huge troublemaker and getting into a ton of fights, so to avoid that, his mom is transferring him to this new uppity Catholic school, and Yami volunteers to go with him to keep an eye on him for their mother's sake. At this new school, she's really hoping for a fresh start. She doesn't want anyone to know that she's queer because she doesn't want a repeat of the experiences that she just had, but things get a little bit more complicated when the only openly queer girl at that school happens to be very kind and very cute. That is, of course, a very simplistic summary. There's a lot more to it, but as I said before, I genuinely and wholeheartedly recommend this book so, so much. And even though I didn't have a book for Emery to sign because obviously I bought E's book on Tuesday, E still gave me this super adorable Cafe Konnichi sticker, which is super freaking cute. I also bought another sticker that just really spoke to me. I will insert a proper photo of it here, but it says, "A woman? No, you misheard. I'm an omen. I don't identify as a man or woman. I identify as a warning." If that's not the brand, then frankly, I don't know what is. I also picked up a second book just because when I go to these in-person events at indie bookstores, I try to pick up at least one more book besides the one that's actually being featured just to show my support if I can. So I grabbed a copy of A Cowboy to Remember by Rebecca Weatherspoon. First of all, what better place to buy like a classic romance novel besides a romance bookstore? And if you can see that sticker, it is autographed by the author as well, so why not? I've been wanting to get into this author's work for quite some time anyways, and also I know Priscilla from Bookie Charm actually recently reviewed this series very positively on her Instagram, I believe, in her Instagram stories, so that was also a big part of why I decided to pick it up. From the very little I know about this series, obviously it's about like cowboys, ranch life, that kind of stuff, but it's also like modern day retellings of fairy tales. If I'm reading this one correctly, I believe this one is a take on Sleeping Beauty. This one, I believe, is about this like celebrity chef named Evie who has some kind of accident that lands her in the hospital with absolutely no memory of who she is. Not quite knowing what to do, in desperation, her assistant contacts the only family that Evie has left, which are these family friends who run a luxury dude ranch in California. Evie, of course, has absolutely no recollection of who these people are, that is, until former rodeo champion Zach Pleasant walks into her hospital room and she realizes his handsome face has been the one haunting her dreams. I'm definitely intrigued. It sounds like it's going to be a good time. Like I said, it's been very positively reviewed by so many people I trust, so I can't wait to get to it. So that is officially a wrap on this week's events. Thank you so much for watching and for joining me on the journey. I hope you enjoyed it. Definitely let me know if you did, and I will catch you next time. Bye!